folks this morning. You know, John has been, we're in chapter 4, starting in verse 1. John has been challenging this church in a lot of different ways, but he keeps interspersing the idea of love. The idea of love. And then he jumps right into something that's challenging. You know, John, these six verses we're going to look at this morning, John must have not been listening when Jesus said, don't judge. He just missed it. Or maybe we're missing how we're trying to interpret that, which we obviously interpreted wrongly. It doesn't say not to judge, it says how to judge. And if you just keep reading things other than three words, you're going to understand that message. If you check it out in Luke, you'll catch it as well. But here you have John giving us a doctrinal test. We've been studying how John gave all different types of tests after he said that we were children of God in chapter 3, verse 1. And he gives different tests, the test of love, the test of righteousness. We're purifying ourselves because he is pure. We're not practicing sin, that he said. We're learning to love like Christ loved us. And now there's this doctrinal test. And he's going to make the statement that there are spirits among us. Now, Paul talked about that. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers and powers and principalities. We see it all through the Old Testament. Daniel dealt with it. We see angels all through the Old Testament. You know, Jacob, he saw them going up and down from heaven on the ladder. But there are the other part as well. Satan fell, and Satan took a third of heaven with him, and a third of the angelic host in his rebellion against God. And very active today are those spirits working in the lives of people that John mentioned in chapter 2 as being not the Antichrist, although that one is coming, but those who have the spirit of Antichrist. They are working against the gospel message. And in chapter 11 of 2 Corinthians, Paul warns us that they appear as servants of righteousness. They're not running around in red suits with horns and pitchforks and saying, you know, with t-shirts saying, I work for the devil. They pretend to work for God. And they distorted just enough about the gospel that it becomes ineffective. That it's no longer the gospel. So John is warning about that because, you know, it's kind of popular today to be non-denominational, which in some areas means non-doctrinal. We just don't talk about those things and we avoid the deeper truths. But let me tell you that whatever won't divide you won't deliver you. Whatever won't divide you won't deliver you. If your belief system is not strong enough to make separation, then it's not setting you aside in a relationship with Christ, with God. Because it demands that we come out of the world. He's called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. So here John is writing about what it means to be a Christian and what you believe and also what you don't believe. And he's warning us that there are different spirits in the world that are speaking into our lives that are trying to draw us away from proper understanding about who Jesus Christ is. So starting in verse 1, if you would join me in standing, if y'all are ready to do that, I'm going to read 6 verses. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God, every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. Is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist, of which you have heard that is coming, and now is already in the world. You are from God, little children. You have overcome them, because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. They are from the world. Therefore, they speak as from the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God. He who knows God listens to us. He who is not from God does not listen to us. By this we know, the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. All right, you may be seated. Beloved, do not believe every spirit. but tests the spirits to see whether they are from God. Many false prophets have gone out into the world. That means you're going to be lied to. You're going to be lied to about spiritual things about God. In fact, you are probably going to be lied to in a way that you're going to be told what you want to hear when it comes to the things about God. And in the midst of all that noise, you've got to strive to hear God. That still small voice that God speaks to us through all of the distractions that the world continually throws at us. So there are going to be two voices that are going to be trying to speak into your life, the Spirit of God and the Spirit of the Antichrist. You've got to figure out what they are, which is which. So in verse 2, he says, by this you know the Spirit of God. You know, why settle for anything less than really hearing God when you have an option to hear God? Why not strive to know that you are actually hearing God and not believe every spirit, but to test those spirits? It says, every spirit that confesses that Christ has come into that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. John 1:14 said, the Word, Jesus Christ, was made flesh and dwelt among us. Now, John is dealing with Gnostic teaching that says the world was so evil that God would have no contact, no relation with anything of this world, which would include human bodies. And so for Christ to be who he was, that he had to be like a phantom, leaving no footprints and have no humanness, flesh about him. So John is making this separation, saying that is of a different spirit. That type of teaching is not the Spirit of God. If you don't believe that Jesus Christ came in the flesh, he had to come in the flesh. He had to die for us. He had to live as a man. The incarnation had to happen. He had to be virgin born so that in his flesh that he would be able to be sinless and not be contaminated with the power of human. He could be fully God, fully man, and live a life that was sinless so that when the time came that he would be an acceptable sacrifice because he would carry no sin of his own to the cross. And our sin could be placed upon him. And he could pay the penalty, pay the debt for our sin. But there are many people who call themselves Christians who are going to listen to any voice that says, I'm speaking for God. And especially if they can throw in a couple of signs and wonders or pretend signs and wonders. And especially if they can say things that this person wants to hear. Man, that sounds great. A very fleshly, carnal message. They are immediately drawn. And, you know, we have them all across, you know, in churches, in the radio, television, internet. It is just avenues for fakes with fake messages today. And there has never been as many, I think, in any generation as what we are dealing with in our day. And many ways of them to get their message out. In chapter 2, John said, children, it is the last hour. Just as you heard that Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have appeared. From this we know that it is the last hour. Jesus said, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing. They come to you. You don't have to go find them. They'll knock at your door. Hey, I got good news for you. They come to you in sheep's clothing. They look like they are coming from God, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. In Acts 20, Paul said, I know, he was talking to the Ephesian church, he said, I know that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from among your own number, men will arise and distort the truth, and they'll draw away disciples after themselves. Therefore, be on the alert. Remember that for 3 years, I never stopped warning each of you, night and day with tears. Kind of important. For 3 years with tears, Paul was warning them. These fakes are going to come. Don't be deceived. In Galatians chapter 1, he said, I'm amazed to the Galatian church that you are quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is not even a gospel. Evidently, some people are troubling you and trying to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we are an angel from heaven should preach. If an angel came in and told me to scoot over and said some stuff, you'd probably listen to that angel, wouldn't you? Just because it's an angel. Even though it may be way off. Paul said, even if an angel comes and preaches a gospel contrary to the one we have preached to you, let him be under a divine curse. As we have said before, so now I say, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you embrace, let him be under divine curse. 2 Timothy 4, preach the word, be prepared in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, encourage with every form of patient instruction. It's Paul talking to a young pastor, Timothy. For the time will come when men will not tolerate doctrine, sound doctrine. But with itching ears, they'll gather around themselves antichrists, teachers to suit their own desires. So they will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. What is that false doctrine? You know, Paul talked about a different gospel to the Galatians. And the part that follows right after warning them of the different gospel, he tells them how he is not preaching that different gospel. And this is what he says. Am I now seeking the approval of men or of God? Am I striving to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a servant of Christ. There's the root of the false gospel. Trying to please men. You know, one of my favorite cereals when I was a kid was Lucky Charms. But I really didn't like most of Lucky Charms. It really wasn't a very good cereal. But you know what? If my mom bought Lucky Charms on Friday, it was marshmallowless by Saturday. I could open that box and go from charm to charm to charm, marshmallow to marshmallow, and clean that thing out. If my brothers got there after me, they'd look in there and all it was just a bunch of old cereal type stuff because the charms were gone. And we're drawn to that. Man, that's the best part. I like that. And so yeah, we want the marshmallows. Kids love marshmallows. Adults love marshmallow sermons. They like the tasty stuff. And the thing is that the last thing that most people need to hear is the first, or last thing that people want to hear is the first thing they need to hear. We're warned over and over to make sure we don't distort the gospel. So this morning, I want you to think of three things. Number one is a false message shares a false Jesus. Everyone that confesses that Jesus has come in the flesh is from God. Everyone that does not confess Jesus is not from God. A false message is going to change one thing for sure. It's going to change who Jesus Christ is. It'll often change whether it's about grace or about works, but it'll change who Jesus Christ is. And a lot of years, the church, the primary focus that the church dealt with was dealing with cults, what we call cults. And they all have a different Jesus. You know, Mormons have a Jesus who's a one of many gods, that he became the savior of this earth, that his God, who had earned the right to be God of this world, like every Mormon man could be, have a God of his own world, that Jesus' plan for salvation was chosen, and Satan was his spirit brother and didn't like that his was chosen over Satan's. Satan got mad and rebelled. That's Mormon doctrine, different Jesus. Jehovah's Witness, Jesus was a created being. He's an archangel. He's a Michael, recreated in it or repackaged in another way. In the New Age, they have a Jesus that's just like a principle that's at work. They talk about Jesus, you know, the Moonies talk about Jesus, the principle, coming upon at John's baptism and then leaving at the cross. Different Jesus, he's just a man. Muslims say that Jesus is just a prophet. He's a good prophet. He's just a prophet, like Muhammad was a prophet. Muhammad was the ultimate prophet. But Jesus will come back and he'll point to Muhammad and say, yeah, Muhammad was right. That's what they say. It's always a different Jesus. And again, in John's day, Jesus was not in the flesh. He was just this phantom that just appeared around and taught wonderful things. The problem that we have today is that fakes are not as recognizable as they used to be. You know, they come up on their bikes with their white shirts. You know, we kind of know there's some Mormons or Jehovah's Witnesses show up or others. But now they're in the church. They're in the pulpits. They have moved in among us because we are no longer discerning in the church world. It is unchristian to call anyone non-Christian. It's tolerance that we don't challenge doctrine anymore. And we, you know, we used to fight armies that had uniforms on. Now we fight terrorists who don't. They come in our midst. And they look like us. And that's what we're dealing with in the church nowadays. They come in our midst and they distort the gospel. And so many people embrace them because in our culture today, we want to hear certain things. And so people run to those messages. You know, Jesus had a mega church. He had a mega church for like a day. When he was feeding people, they were coming out of the woodwork. And then he started talking about the hard issues of discipleship and why he came. And boom, his church went down to 12. And one of them wasn't a good one at all. And he asked them, "Are you going to go?" Everybody else left when I started really talking about the serious nature of what it means to follow God, take up your cross and follow me, deny yourself. Oh, where'd they go? It's the message of the gospel. It's not the marshmallow. It's the vitamins. It's the real thing that brings nourishment. 2 Corinthians 11, it says, "For such men are false apostles, deceitful workers, disguising themselves," literally masquerading themselves, "as apostles of Christ." No wonder, literally surprise, no surprise, for even Satan disguises himself, masquerades himself as an angel of light. Therefore, it's not surprising if his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness. You know, if you travel around the world, or you take a cruise, go down to some of these cruise ports, you'll probably find somebody there when you get off the boat or you travel, get off the plane, that is willing to sell you a Rolex watch or a Gucci purse. And it's a really good price. Thing is, it's not the real deal. But the price is what you want to pay. So you convince yourself, well, I can just strut around and everybody will believe it's real. And I won't have to pay the price for the real thing. And a lot of people are sold a fake Jesus because he's offered at the price that they're willing to pay. You know, Robbie Zacharias, in a book called Why Jesus, he talked about a man who made a prediction about American culture because of what American culture was headed toward. And he described what the church would become in this type of culture. And the word that he used was minimalist. Minimalist. Where everything would have to be lowered to the least possible level. What is the least I can be? What is the least I can believe? What's the least I can do and still be a Christian? And pastors would ask, what is the minimal message that I can preach to keep a crowd? I don't want to lose my crowd. I got to pay for things. The best lie is that which looks the most like the truth. And the mark of spiritual maturity is not just belief, but unbelief. Knowing what to believe, but also knowing what not to believe. To know what to agree with, but also being able to discern what is wrong. Second thing is, a false messenger sells a false Jesus. Not just a false message teaches, but a false messenger. Verse 5 says, "They are from the world. Therefore, they speak as from the world, and the world listens to them." So a false messenger will say that he speaks for God, but his message will be more consistent with the world rather than God. And you think about some of the things that can be said in the church that the lost world would agree about, kind of the lowest common things. Number one, I want to feel good about myself and have hope for eternity. Number two, I want to learn to have a healthy, well-adjusted family. Number three, I want a safe and positive place for my kids where they can meet other kids. Number four, I want to have a good group of friends to draw from. Number five, I want to belong somewhere. And number six, I want to hear the type of music that appeals to me. So you incorporate all these things and you get a life coach and call him pastor, and then here we go, we're off. And we discover that our generation's kind of bought into a fake watch. And it appears to cost them nothing, but Jesus didn't offer that. He didn't offer anything that didn't cost us anything. And they want to get to heaven at the price that they want to pay. And the problem with the lowest common church, it produces the lowest common Christian. And a soft faith, an unsurrendered life shows no change and brings no change to a lost world. That's why Paul went around and he preached Christ crucified. He said, I've been crucified with Christ. I'm no longer my own. He said, I've been bought with a price. I'm no longer my own. We are to tell the world why Jesus Christ lived and why he died so that they can understand what real Christianity is all about. And if they don't, they don't have the hope that comes through Christ, because the hope is based on the truth about who he was and what he did and us embracing the reality of exactly what happened and why. You know, I've gone to Rangers games sometimes, and a lot of people at the Rangers games, you look around and it's just blue. Everywhere is blue. They got the hats on, they got the shirts on. Some of them are actually wearing jerseys with other people's names on them. Just everywhere, Ranger blue. And some of this stuff is really expensive. Tickets are expensive, parking's expensive. From here, it's a long drive to get to the stadium. And people are sitting in the stands and they are just excited every time the Rangers score or hit or making out, they get all excited. In that stadium, tens of thousands of people. There's really only like 20-something Rangers that are real. And then you got the other folks that are kind of working for the Ranger organization. But everybody's wearing the same color. Everybody's rooting for the same things that the real Rangers are trying to achieve on the field. But those in the stands really aren't Rangers. As excited as they are, they're really not true Rangers. And some of the clues that might indicate that. First, if they took the same field as the Rangers, it wouldn't look good. It would look bad. And a lot of lost people don't do well at saved things. They don't know what they need to know. So they're always stumbling and not able to respond to the world. They don't prepare like they need to prepare. They don't share like they need to share. And when they try to take the field for Christ, it's a train wreck. Because they're not new creations and they're not hungering and thirsting for the Word of God, and walking in tune in a relationship with God through His Holy Spirit speaking into their life. The second thing is lost people don't do well at saved tasks. You know, somebody, if I was sitting there and somebody would have come up to me and asked me the question, are you one of us, sitting there at the stadium? I said, yeah, I'm one of us. Okay, here's a broom. We need these steps cleaned off, and the bathroom's looking bad, so could you get in there and clean the bathroom for us? I said, well, I'm a spectator, right? I didn't come here to do other people's jobs. I just came here because I want to wear blue. I look good in blue, and I want to watch a game. I want to root for a team. And someone else can help with that need. Someone else can teach a class. Someone else can give. Someone else can share their faith. I'm just a fan. I'm really not a player. And there are churches that are filled with fans. They enjoy the environment. They'd like to dress the part, cheer the part. But they're just fans. And a false messenger is going to promote or teach about a false Jesus. And not the true one that demands a surrendered life of complete devotion. We are from God. He who knows God listens to us. He who is not of God does not listen to us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. The true gospel His call upon us is that we must admit and confess our sin, reject the old life, embrace the life in Christ, and strive to become heroes for the cause of Christ. We are to strive for the maximum, not the minimum. And the message of the cross calls us to the maximum. There is no minimalist. That has nothing to do with Christianity. It's always about the maximum. And this gospel calls us out of the world to live radically different from it by the power of the Holy Ghost. And the world doesn't like that message. They're going to respond to an environment that reflects where their heart is. A true, you know, what he's saying is right people are going to listen to the right message. Others' message is going to have to be manipulated to embrace some of the things that are in the heart of a person of the world. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and they follow me." A true believer can never have too much asked of them. God can never ask too much of me. He can never demand too much of my life, because I understand what he did for me. I understand what he saved me from. And I understand what he's placed in my life, who he's placed in my life, and what the potential is. And a true believer desires to know God, to hear from God, to serve God, and to live for God. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. And third thing is, a false message steals great potential. Verse 4, you thought we jumped it. We're going back. "You are from God, little children, and overcome and have overcome them, because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world." A genuine Christian life is a horrible thing to miss. Greater. Jesus called it the abundant life. Paul called it indescribable. Paul also said we're overcomers, we're more than conquerors. And here you have John using great to describe what is possible. Greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. Great is a great word. You know, I might settle for pretty good, good, really good. If Jesus said, "I'm going to give you a really good life," I said, "Yes, really good life." Great. Great is possible, because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. So whatever my struggle, whatever my temptation is, I can know with confidence that God has placed within us a life in the Spirit that is more than able to maintain our victory. Greater is he who is in me. Greater is he who is in you than anything you're going to face out in that world. There's someone great in us. And the longer we try to do things with our own wisdom, our own powers, we don't need to be surprised that we're going to fail. And we're not going to achieve the level that God has called us to and made us potentially able to live out. We have someone great in us to guide us, empower us, to teach us. Someone great in us to trust and believe in every day. Someone greater than all of us combined. Paul said, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Philippians 4. Philippians 1, it said, "He who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus." We need to learn to get out of the way and let the victory of Christ that he's purchased for us to play itself out in our life. Because greater than the one who wants in you, the one who's in the world, he wants in us. But the one who is in us is greater than that one who wants in our life. But we're never going to be successful against our enemy in our own strength. You know, Satan was the highest created being, highest in wisdom, highest in power, highest in intelligence. If you're going to take him on, good luck. But he's already been defeated. You just need to enter into that victory. And the ground of our victory is our identification with the victory that Christ has already accomplished for us. We need to understand that, that there is something greater at work, and we need to embrace that. Instead of a different Jesus that gets us totally off track and doesn't lead to a Christianity that gains the benefits of all those relationships that we have with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit in the true nature of who they are. You know, what does a different Jesus look like? Well, the world talks about a different Jesus. They talk about a good man. They talk about a great teacher. They talk about an example to follow. They talk about someone who loves me too much to judge me or condemn me. Read your Bible. And there are a lot of worldly messages that have made their way in the church. And a worldly message, number one, it centers around man and not Christ. It's more about hearing about me, what's in this for me, than who Christ is, and celebrating and worshiping him. A worldly message will excuse sin, exalt man, stress ego or self-image. It'll give man the right to exercise his self-will. It'll focus on success, position, money, power, possessions, and most of all, a worldly message will neglect the cross. Might not even put it up in the church. Got to hide that thing. People may get offended. Philippians 3, 18 and 19, it says, "For many walk, of whom I have often told you, and now tell you, even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite, whose glory is in their shame, and who set their minds on earthly things, on a different Jesus, on a fake watch." Their end is not just a rap on the hand on the knuckles. They're enemies of the cross. And James warned us, don't strive to be a teacher. Because there's going to be a higher accountability of judgment for those who pretend to stand up and be a spokesman for God. And if you do that and you distort the gospel at any point that negates its power at any level, you don't want to be them on judgment day. But let me close by telling you, a bank teller that I heard about described a course that they took in counterfeit money. And the teacher brought all these samples of counterfeits, and you probably heard it before, but the focus of the course was knowing what a real bill looked like. And so the course was more about handling a lot of real cash, and they would get a certain feel for what real money was about. And a good teller can tell, and now you know why they call them tellers, because they can tell if it's money or not, if it's real or not. They can tell a counterfeit just by the feel of it on their fingers. And for a true believer who's genuine in their faith, a knower should know truth. If you truly know who Jesus Christ is, and you're truly living out the calling that he's placed upon our lives, and, you know, in his word, walking obediently, living in a prayerful way with him, that we won't have so many problems that many people have with the lies and deceptions of those spirits who are of the world. And a compass, it's a valuable tool because it always points to that magnetic field up on the north. And God's word on every page